Good evening. Shana tova, everyone. Hope your Rosh Hashanah was meaningful. And hopefully we were coming to a new year with new, better decrees than the last one. This shiur will be lerfuat Yaakov ben Rina. It will be leilui nishmat Linda bat Batya. And Nissan Ben Zekeya. I hope I pronounced it correctly. And also להצלחה ומציאת שידוך of Yosef Ben Emmanuel. And לזיווג יפה בת ויקטוריה, גילה בת ויקטוריה, and to הצלחה of חיים בן ויקטוריה, ציון בן ויקטוריה, ויקטוריה בת יפה, and also לעילוי נשמת יצחק בן לינדה, and יפה בת שרה. I hope I covered everyone that asked me. טוב, one announcement, those who still want to join me on Yom Kippur, men only, in Englewood, New Jersey. Email me, rabbimizrachi@gmail.com. We still have a few rooms available. It's going to be wonderful Yom Kippur. We did it for the last 12, 13 years. And we daven nets. Then we learn. Then we have a rest before Mincha and Neila, that we started like fresh. It's usually if you pray all day straight, by the time you get to the Mincha and Neila, you're dizzy already. With headaches. Over here, you start like fresh, which means you have a lot of energy to finish the Yom Kippur correctly. Today, as you see, there was Tzom Gedalia, the fast of Gedalia, one of the fasts that Chazal made us over 2,000 years ago. And this is one of the four fasts that relates to the destruction of the temple. But it's a little bit different. When we have Asara Betevet, they broke the wall, Shvayisre Betamuz, they actually, you know, enter Yerushalayim, we have Tisha B'Av, they destroy the temple. Everything is related directly to the destruction of the temple. This was actually the destruction of the Jewish community. In the destruction of the first temple by the Babylonians, the second Nebuchadnezzar, that came after the destruction, he actually gave the power to Gedalia. Gedalia ben Achikam, he was a tzaddik, reliable, and he said, I'm making you a governor. You be in charge, you collect the taxes. As long as you pay us the taxes, monthly or annually, we won't bother you. We give you autonomy. You run your country, and you still have a Jewish community here, no problem. Once you mess up, money comes short, or you dare to rebel against us, that will be the end of you. So, you know, most of the Jews, anyway, they sent to exile. There wasn't such a big community. So, you know, they work in vineyards and all kinds of fruits, and they had to give them percentage to these Babylonians, the king of Babylon. And what happened is that this was, back then it was Israel and Judah, was divided to two authorities. And the prophet Yirmiyahu was alive in that time. He actually backed him up. Nobody would dare to go against him. So once Yirmiyahu backed him up, everybody actually paid him the taxes to these Babylonians, and it was going on. As it's described in the book of Yirmiyah, Jeremiah, this Gedalia was murdered today, on the third of Tishrei. There is another opinion that he was actually murdered on Rosh Hashanah, but because on Rosh Hashanah you can't fast, so it postponed it to the day after. One way or the other, he was murdered beginning of Tishrei, and he was murdered by Jewish people, Ishmael ben Natania. He had a gang, a group of people. It was actually, some say that this was the first political murder in the land of Israel. You know, we had Yitzhak Rabin in our days, 20-something years ago, that was murdered by a person that disagreed with his agenda. There were many different attacks, political attacks. But one thing we do know is that this Ishmael ben Natania, people came to Gedalia and warned him. He was an important person from a descendants of a kingdom. And they came to Gedalia and they told him, they prepare for you an ambush to kill you. Be careful from this Ishmael. The Yohanan, it was a person named Yohanan. Yohanan, he was the king of the army, Yohanan ben Korach, and his people. They came to Ishmael and they came to Gedalia and warned him from Ishmael, begging him to attack him first. Before he will come to you, that will be too late already. But Gedalia was what we call too much of a tzaddik. He did not want to hear Lashon Hara. If somebody comes to you and say, I have news for you that someone is planning to kill you, you're allowed to listen or no? You must listen. If you don't listen, you're a fool. You listen and you be cautious. If it happened, at least you were prepared for it. You saved yourself. If it didn't happen, no big deal. Nothing happened. This person was a liar. One way or the other, but he can't take a risk. It's affect pikuach nefesh. So he did not want to accept this Lashon Hara. He didn't want to hear. And what happened? He was murdered as he was sitting in a mitzpeh. Mitzpeh, it's a high place that you look down, you know, like you look in all the valleys below. Where is it? You know where Prophet Samuel grave? It's close to Amot. If you know Yerushalayim, you take Shmuel Anavi, the street Shmuel Anavi, you drive towards Ramot. Ramot will be on your right side. Once you finish all the Ramot neighborhood, which is a very big neighborhood, then you have this big tower of the grave of Shmuel, Samuel the prophet. So over there, he was right there. And they came and they killed him. And not only that, there was some Babylonian soldiers who were there with him, you know, helping him to keep the order over there. They killed them as well. This was in the middle of a meal that Gedalia made for Ishmael ben Natania. He actually made him a meal, and in return he killed him. You understand? So he killed him in the middle of the Seuda. And this was, who was behind all of that? The king of Ammon, Ammoni and Moavi, right? We have a history with them. So this king of Ammon was the one behind it. They were instigating. What are you fools? You're paying taxes to these Babylonians. How long are you going to be, you know, taking advantage of? How long it's going to be? So once Gedalia was murdered, the end of the Jewish autonomy in Israel arrived. This was after the destruction of the first temple. And the rest of the nation were scattered. Some went to Egypt because they escaped from the Babylonians. They knew they were on the way to kill everybody. Right? So some escaped to Egypt. And the rest to all different directions. And that was actually the end of Jewish possession in the Holy Land. That's why it's a big tragedy. It wasn't just the death of one tzaddik. We had, today, in history, we had many different the tzaddikim that were murdered or killed. Not for everyone we're going to make a fast. If that's the case, we'll have to fast all year round. Right? But this murder was not just a murder of a righteous person. It was actually the destruction of the Jewish community in the Holy Land. Meaning, if this would not happen, eventually one day we'll get rid of the Babylonians and we will be able to rebuild the community in Israel. Because of what happened, we actually lost control completely in the land of Israel, and that's why we fasted today, the Tzom Gedalia. And Rosh Hashanah, there is a tragic story that we read. It's in the Sidurim of Rosh Hashanah. It's called Maaseh de Rabbi Amnon Zal, Mimagenza. He was Gdol Ador, was a big rabbi, big chacham, and very rich, and comes from a very important family. And also very handsome. Everything a man needs, he had. Knowledge, wisdom, money, look, and yichus, great genealogy. What else do you need? He's a very important person. And the king and the ministers, the Christians, Christian Inquisition, they put pressure on him to convert to Christianity. When they actually gathered him, they took him and they said, we want you to join us. Of course, you know how they, with their sweet talk, you join us, we'll give you, we'll make you important. It's the stick and the carrot. If you're with us, we'll give you the carrot. If not, you get the stick. He made a mistake. It slipped out of his mouth. He said, give me 3 days to consult. 3 days. He thought maybe he's going to earn some time. As he walked out from them, he regretted the answer that he gave them. He regretted. He said, wow, what did I just say? It sounds like I had some kind of a doubt about my Judaism. And that's not the case. Of course, I will not convert to this fake religion. So what happened? He got very worried. I made a mistake. I should have not said that. He did not eat, did not drink. In the third day, they sent someone to call him. And he refused to go to the king. So they, by force, they brought him. The king spoke very rough to him. He said, Amnon, I will judge you one way or the other. The tongue that spoke lie... No, so Amnon, Rabbi Amnon said to him, you don't have to judge me. I will judge myself. The tongue that say a lie should be cut. Meaning, how did I even dare to tell you that? Give me 3 days to think. How did I dare? It was a lie. I never considered converting. So the king said, no, the tongue actually say the truth, but your legs... Your legs did not cooperate. That's why we will chop your legs and we will torture the rest of your body. So what did they do? They chopped the fingers and the toes from his body. I don't have to tell you the pain. With a sharp axe. And everyone that they used to cut, they asked him, would you change your mind? No. Boom. Chopped another finger. That's what they used to do to a lot of people, not only to him. But this case is famous. Other people, anonymous, they torture them, these Christians. It's very interesting. I mean, today, the world is very scary about the Muslims. Muslims, terror, attacks, here, there, bombs, suicide bombers, Al-Qaeda, ISIS, horrible, very cruel. You saw what ISIS do to people, I don't have to tell you. But a lot of people already forgot that the Christian was 1,000 times worse. In history, we suffer a lot more than the Christians and the Muslims. Muslims, it came in waves. Here and there, boom, attacks. Most of the time was quiet. Jews live among them in all kinds of Arab countries. But these Christians, it's a missionary religion. You don't join us, we'll kill you. We'll torture you first. They torture thousands of Jews in the most horrible tortures. And this was just one example. As they finished to chop his fingers and toes, they laid him in bed, and the fingers next to him on the bed, and the toes. And they say, okay, now you can go home. Why did he call himself Amnon? Because he believed in Hashem. Amnon, Emunah, right? Comes from the word Emunah. And Rosh Hashanah, he asked to take him to the synagogue, next to the Chazan, the Shliach Tzibur, that pray. And that's when he went there. No, so what happened is, one line I skip. So after they chopped his toes and fingers, he died actually, and he came to in a dream to this is very interesting. The story is over here is wrong. That's why I got confused. They missed part of the story. The real story is that he came to Rav Klonimus in a dream, and he told him on Rosh Hashanah, before we read Kedusha, he gave him by a dream, like a prophecy, he gave him these words that we read in some synagogues, Ufchenu lecha ta'ale Kedusha ki ata melech, and he told him to read it on Rosh Hashanah. So this Amnon died on Kiddush Hashem. I don't have to tell you, the Rambam writes, the reward of someone who gives his life, that meaning they ask him to convert to a fake religion or to bow down to an idol, and he gives his life and refuses to do it, he goes to the highest level in heaven, express. It's called Aruge Malchut, right? And the name of this dream, this the information that he gave in a dream, it's called Untana Tokef. Untana Tokef. What is Untana Tokef? Tokef means like ability. You know, once he died, 3 days later, he came to Rav Klonimus, son of Rabbi Meshulam, and he gave him this whole piyut, this entire piyut, as we read it in Rosh Hashanah, Uvchen, ulecha ta'ale kedusha ki ata melech. The main thing in this piyut, that's why it relates to Rosh Hashanah, is that everybody scream, תשובה ותפילה וצדקה, וצדקה מעבירים את רוע הגזרה. 3 things can cancel the bad decrees. 1 is תשובה, which I'm going to talk about now. 2, תפילה. שחרית, alone with מוסף, is about 7 hours in most places. 7 hours you pray in the first day, 7 hours in the second day. Then you go, you have the meal, you cannot sleep, so you read Tehillim. After Tehillim, you pray Mincha, then you give Shiur, then you pray Arvit, then you go home, you make Seudat Yom Tov. Again, 5 o'clock in the morning, you wake up, you go to the synagogue, second day, next. This is a lot of prayers. But prayers is not enough. You need also repentance, Tshuva. And we will review now, what does it mean? And one more thing, lots of Tzedakah, charity. But a charity that hurts. Not charity that it's easy. If you make millions and you give $1,000, that's a joke. You spend it on a dinner with your wife. That's not such a sacrifice. Bachur yeshiva that gives $1,000, that's a fortune for him, obviously. Oh, wow. It takes him a long time to save $1,000. But it's all depend on who you are. So 3 things. 3 things, Rabotai. Tshuva, ותפילה וצדקה מעבירים את רוע הגזירה. One more thing, I want to read to you in the prayers of the עשרת ימי תשובה from Rosh Hashanah until end of Yom Kippur. You all know we have additions to the prayers. We have one change. Instead of Ha'el HaKadosh, you have to say Ha'melech HaKadosh, the Holy King. If you forgot to say Amelech, you have to go back to the beginning and restart the whole prayer. Why? This is critical. Then later you have to say המלך המשפט. Instead of מלך אוהב צדקה ומשפט, המלך המשפט. Because there's an argument between the חכמים, what happened if you forgot to say המלך המשפט, if you have to repeat or no. Some say yes, some say no. When we have an argument like this, ספק ברכות להקל. We rather not saying the name of Hashem in vain, in case the other side is right, and you don't have to repeat, then you repeat the name of Hashem for no reason. Therefore, if you forgot to say המלך המשפט, you don't have to go back to the beginning. But you have to be very careful not to forget, because some say that you have to repeat the whole davening. Why should you come inside the machloket? All the other four editions, you don't have to go back to the beginning if you forgot. But I want to review it for 1 minute with you and teach you a little secret here. We begin right by now by saying, Zochrenu lechaim, melech hafetz b'chaim. Remember us for life, a king that is interested in life. Kotvenu b'sefer chaim, write us in a book of life. Lema'anach Elohim chaim, for your sake, a living God. The second edition is, Mi chamocha avarachaman, who is like you, the merciful Father. Zocher yitzurav berachamim lechaim. Remember his creature with mercy for life. Two of these provisions, it's talking about life. In the end, it's a little bit different. Most people don't pay attention. There's a reason why there's a difference. So the extra editions, in the end, is Uchtov lechaim tovim kol bnei beritecha, and write to good life all the people of your covenant, meaning the Jewish nation. And in the end, we add in the book of life, blessing and peace and good living, and salvation and comfort and good decrees, we should be remembered and be written in front of you. We and the entire nation of Israel for good life and peace. Bless you, God, that bless his nation with peace. So, what's the difference between the first two editions to the last two? Who paid attention? Did you realize that there is one major difference? I'll tell you the difference. In the first two, we don't say Chaim Tovim. We only say Chaim, Zochrenu Lechaim, remember us for life. Mi chamocha av rachman zocher yitzurav berachamim lechaim. Doesn't say Chaim Tovim. Chaim, only life. In the end, we ask for Chaim Tovim, the last two. Why? The answer is, as you remember, once I had a lecture, Preparation for Eternal Life. That's how we name my book, based on that lecture. That I explain over there, that every time the Torah or the Tanakh is speaking about Chaim, the word Chaim is only talking about life of the soul, life of eternity. Not the life of the body, life of the soul. That's why the life of the soul, it's obvious that it's good. You don't need to say, remember us for good life. When we go to heaven, can it be bad? There's no point of saying good. The last two is speaking about life here in this materialistic world, right here. That's why we have to specify Chaim Tovim. The first two is in a spiritual part of the davening. All the way to Amelech HaKadosh, from the beginning, Hashem Sfatai Tiftach, this whole part is spiritual. The resurrection of the dead, the salvation, curing the sick. We're not talking about bodies. It's the doctor of the souls. How do we know? Because later on in Tfilat Shmona Esre, we already ask Hashem to cure us. Baruch Atah Hashem Rofe Chole Amo Yisrael. Later on. Over here we already say Rofe Cholim. Right? But over here in the beginning, pay attention to what we're saying. We say the great God, the hero, the upper that owns everything, and remember the goodness of the fathers, meaning Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, and bring salvation to his children with love. And what's the blessing? Bless you, God, the Savior of Abraham. It's all spiritual. Then, reviving the dead, supporting the people who collapse, curing the souls, releasing prisoners. Which prisoner is talking about? Not people in jail. Which prisoner? The soul that was captured by the Yetzer Hara, by the Satan. People that are prisoners of the Satan, of the Yetzer Hara. And otherwise, what does it have to do with Mechaye Amitim? What is it? What do you have to put it in this blessing? Put it in a different blessing. Who are you? Who are like you? The king that kill and revive and bring salvation. We're only talking about spirituality here. That's why we are talking about give us life, meaning write us in a book of life, life of eternity. In the end, well, after we say modim, we thank you, then we make the request. Give us this, give us that. Okay, so we make requests for all kinds of parnasa and health and good life, everything we need for this world. One thing you have to know, there is a question why we say, Baruch Ata Hashem Rofe Chole Amo Yisrael. Bless you, God, the one who brings remedy to the nation of Israel. So first question is, God also give cure to the Goyim. If a Goy is sick, if he got cure, who cured him? Same God. So why you only say, it's actually a downgrade to Hashem. If you say that he's only curing the Jewish nation, actually you take away from his glory. Because how many Jews you have in the world? 15 million? You have 7.5 billion goyim. Better to say, bless you God, the doctor of all mankind, of humanity. That means I'm a doctor of 7.5 billion people. Plus all the generation that passed, that's maybe 100 billion. If you're only talking about the Jews, it's not even 1% of the world. The answer is because we are not talking here about doctor of the bodies. We're not talking about the doctor of a body. What are we talking about? Doctor of the soul. And that's only to the Jews because they have Torah. The Goyim don't have Torah. So there's no way to cure the soul without Torah. No way. The only way to cure the pride, ego, anger, stinginess, laziness, selfishness, all this lack of emunah, you know, faith issues, confidence in God. All this is only with the Torah. No psychologist can cure you. No book can cure you. No doctor can cure you when you have these mental diseases such as pride, ego. You want to be the highlight of everywhere you go. You want to steal the show. You're very hungry for attention. You have no confidence, low self-esteem. All these mental issues. There's only one doctor for these problems. What is it? The book of God. There's no other way to cure a person. No other way. That's why we highlight the fact that Baruch Ata Hashem Rofe Chole Amo Israel. You gave your nation the cure that the rest of the world doesn't have. What is it? The Torah. Otherwise, when it speaks about the body, of course, God is the doctor of the goyim, of the animals, of everyone. Everyone who lives and moves around, he needs remedy, he comes to God, and the goyim knows it as well. One more thing. In Rosh Hashanah, if you paid attention, the first day we read, V'Hashem pakad et Sarah. Hashem made Sarah pregnant after many years. She was 90 years old. 90 years old already. She never won. It's double miracle. First, the age. Imagine today a woman 90 years old will come and say to the world, I just became pregnant. The whole world will talk about it for months. Doctors from all over the world will come to ask to check her. What do you have that other women don't have? Right? That's a very big miracle. It's true, we have to take into consideration that the nature was very different than today. And people lived to 180, 175. So you see, average life was more than double than today. So 90, based on that, is not such a big deal. If today a woman can give birth up to 45, 50, let's say,
naturally. So 90 wasn't like such a huge thing compared to those days. So the real big miracle wasn't the age so much, because Yocheved, when she gave birth, she was 127. A bigger miracle, and nobody made a big deal out of it. She was giving birth ben Hashmashot. So based on that, the Ramban say that the age here was not really the main miracle. The main miracle was that Sarah naturally was born with no womb. A woman without womb can give birth. That was the very big miracle. But anyway, the first day we read about Hashem made Sarah pregnant. She gave birth to Yitzchak, and they have Ishmael. And Ishmael is a wild beast. And Sarah comes to Abraham and she says, listen, you cannot keep this wild beast and his mother here in the house. She is the one who told him, go have a child with her. Right? When she saw she cannot have kids. So now, why do we have to read such a part of the Torah in the holiest day of the year, the judgment day? What do we care about the story of Ishmael now? From all the stories of the Torah, you have to speak about this Arab. Huh? This is a Chachamim. What's going on? You have to understand what's going on over here. First day is the Oraita. Second day is the Rabbanan. So the first day, we should have read what we read in the second day. Vayi achar hadevarim ha'ele, v'elokim nisa et Avraham, akedat Yitzchak. The horn, the shofar, this is all relates to Rosh Hashanah. The akedat Yitzchak, there's mercy on the Jewish nation every day, thanks to the akedat Yitzchak. So this should have been written, should have been read in the first day. And the story of Hashem Pakad et Sarah and all that could have been the second day. Two answers why it's not like that. First, what was the right chronological order? First Sarah became pregnant, or first there was the Akedah? First she became pregnant. That was the beginning of the whole process of the miracle. That's fine. So you had to read it in the first time. First day, and the rest of the story in the second day. But there is a bigger reason for it. When Sarah came to Abraham and she told him, Garesh et ha'ama hazot, kick out of the house this servant, Hagar, and her son, the wild beast. Why? He's going to ruin Yitzchak. He stays over here another year or two, Yitzchak will be finished spiritually. When you have a rotten apple in a basket, everybody knows the only way to save the rest of the apples is to get rid of the rotten apple. If you insist to keep it, it's your loss. Everybody else will die with it. You think you're smart, you actually lost more than you gained. Same thing if you have a nemek, if no blood goes into a leg. It happens to people with diabetics, lo aleinu, that they chop their legs. It's very common, even today. Even today with modern medicine and all the inventions, they still don't have the cure for diabetics. And they still chop legs all over the world of people that have problems in their legs. So it's called nemek in Lashon HaKodesh. Nemek means that there's no blood circulation. And the leg becomes already numb. And that's a piece of meat. That's it. There's no life there. And it's growing. It's like cancer. It keeps going higher and higher and higher. Soon it's going to go to the rest of the body and you die. So what's the cure? Chop the legs off and save the rest of the body. So the Gemara brings a story of a goy. His name was Ktia Bar Shalom. Ktia. The name hints who he was. Ktia means to chop, liktoa, to chop something, like chop a tree or chop a leg. Ktia Bar Shalom, son of a peace. What's the story with him? There was a king, and he asked, after the Romans, they occupied the world and they came to Israel, they didn't know what to do with the Jews. Should we kill them or should we keep them alive like the rest of the nation that they should pay us taxes? The rest of the world, they didn't hate. People don't hate other people. Everybody hates Jews, but they don't hate each other naturally unless there is the arguments about land or war, something like that. Naturally, they're all allergic to the Jewish people because this is the way God made it. That's a part of the plan, that we will have a guard, that no matter what, we'll always have a gun to our heads not to forget who we are. It's written clearly. Am lebadad ishkon uvagoyim lo itchashav. The Jewish nation is an isolated nation and can never be a part of the rest of the world. It's always going to be an isolated nation, no matter what. When the Jews are rich, when they poor, when they smart, when they're not smart, they have their land, they're out of their land, no matter where, no matter what, they're always going to be hated. Why? No reason. They hate them for things that they should hate themselves. But they don't hate themselves, they hate them. That's reality. Esav sone le Yaakov. That's it. There's nothing you can do about it. So what the Jews have to do to keep low profile, not to instigate the bear or the lion, as long as he's happy and give him enough food, he leaves you alone. If you come and flash your Mercedes everywhere and your big mansions and you control all the positions in the government, then when things are not working for the goyim, they go crazy. As long as they eat well and their businesses are booming, they can live with these annoying Jews. But once things are not so good and there's corona and the stock market maybe crash, and the people lose their homes, right away, wave of anti-Semitism. Like 2008, like 2020. Now, if you search online, you cannot believe what the Nazi speeches they put in their face. We're not hiding their identity. They're not even embarrassed. Speak mamash the words of Hitler in social media. Not one or two. We're talking hundreds of thousands everywhere. You can say, oh, but it's only 1%. Maybe. Maybe 1%, maybe 2%. But you don't need more than that. Hitler was one person. And you saw what he did in Europe. All you need is a few crazy ones, and they gather everyone together. That's what's going on. But of course, this is all in the hand of Hashem. So this Ktia Bar Shalom, the king asked, a person that has a nemek in his leg, meaning no blood circulation, what's better, to cut it or to leave it full? What do you think is better? So the king is hinting, what should I do? Should I keep the Jews because they are like cancer in the world? Should I keep them alive because it's an emic? Later they're going to take over the whole world if I keep them alive. I will regret it. Oh, I should chop them now, kill them now. Okay, so the world will not be complete. And I occupy all the world, but one nation I could not handle. So I had to kill them, right? What should I do? So this goy, Ktia Bar Shalom, was defending the Jews. He said, you have to leave the Jews alive. You cannot kill them. So he asked him why. He said, because if you kill them, you will be remembered in history as a coward. That from the whole world you were not afraid, but you were afraid of the Jews. That's why you needed to kill them, because you're afraid that they're smarter than you and they overpower you. Look how clever he was. He touched his ego. And he said to him, you're right, you gave a very good answer, but because you annoyed me, we will kill you anyway. Take him to death. How they used to kill people? They used to choke them with dust. You know how you choke a person with dust? You take them into a closed room. There's a lot of soft sand. And they have some masks. The people, they throw the sands in the air. And it's all dusty. And they breathe it into the lung. After an hour, the lung become a chunk of mud. And obviously they die. They cannot live. So as they taking Ktia Bar Shalom to death, there was a fancy lady, Matronita, another Goya. She felt bad for him. She also liked the Jews. So she started to sing. She couldn't talk to him. The soldiers are holding him. So she started to sing a song. How sad to see a boat that sailed across the ocean and arrived to their destination, and they did not have enough money to pay the duty to enter the merchandise. Now they have to go all the way back to the country to bring new money. Remember, in the old days, boat wasn't like today with motors. People, you know, either they sail like this or they have with the wind. It can take months. And she's hinting to him, Why are you such a fool? You giving your life to defend the Jews and you gonna die like a goy? At least you would convert first, then come and defend them. Don't you know you would end up dead? He got the point. In a moment that the soldiers did not pay attention, somehow he took something sharp and circumcised himself. And he say, I paid my duty. I paid my taxes. And the Gemara say, there was an announcement that moment in heaven, Ktiya bar shalom mezuman lechaya olam haba. This goy, Ktiya bar shalom, is welcome to life of eternity where the Jews go. If you ask, how do you know the Jews have different life than the goyim when they die? How do you know? Maybe the Jews are thinking that they are something special for no reason, right? You need a proof. So the same Torah that the goyim admit that is the word of God, and they admit that we got it from God in Mount Sinai in a public event. They're not denying it, not the Christians, not the Muslims. It's written over there, the words of the prophet of the goyim. Who was he? Bilam. Bilam, the prophet of the goyim, said the prophecy after Balak hired him to curse the Jewish nation. And God said to him, don't dare to curse. Whatever I'll put in your mouth, you will speak. Nothing on your own. And when he came to curse, he actually blessed. He came to curse and he ended up blessing. While he was giving his prophecy and blessing, there is one very important sentence over there. Everything is important, of course, but that one is the highlight of his speech. What does it say? Tamut nafshi mot yesharim, v'tihi achariti kamohu. I would like to die like the Jews die. And I want my end to be like the end of the Jews. Yeshurun is Am Israel. How do you know Yeshurun is Am Israel? This Shabbat you will remember me. When you come to Shul and they read in the Torah, Parashat Azinu. Tomorrow I'll speak about the Blin Eder in Brooklyn. It's also like a prophecy. Moshe Rabbeinu this time. Azinu Hashamayim V'Adabera, right? Heaven and earth should listen to be witness to my words. So what Moshe say? Vaishman yeshurun vaivat. You became fat, meaning you eat and you enjoy too much and you forgot Hashem, you became ungrateful. Vaishman yeshurun vaivat. Shamanta avita kasita. The fatter you become, the less head you have for your God. It's so true. You see it today. The more you are in materialism, the less spiritual you can be. It's impossible to be both at the same time. When you are very, very addicted to material, it's very difficult to be connected to Torah and the simple lifestyle of the Torah. Why? It's a torture for you. Because you want the fancy life. Later, when you begin to listen to good speakers and they wake you up from your dream and from your illusion and from your nonsense, slowly, slowly, after a period of time that listening to a lot of lecture, you come to realization that until now your life was really all fake. You invested so much money in materialism, in houses, in cars, in jewelry, and now it doesn't excite you anymore because you already understand that this is all baloney. None of that will come with me to the life of eternity. And definitely it's not the will of God that I'll be like a drug addict every month, a new car, or every month a new toy to keep me happy. So once you begin to be connected to the Torah, you realize that the rest of the things is all nonsense. After a while, you're not excited anymore by materialism. You may have beautiful things, but it doesn't interest you anymore. Meaning, before you started to listen, one scratch on the wall, you would not sleep for 2 days. One scratch. Or if a new phone came out, you could not wait a day before you want to switch to the new one. Why? You're mentally sick. It's a mental disease. Once you started to learn Torah, you don't care anymore to stay with your phone even 2 years, 3 years, as long as it works. Who cares? It's working. can send email, I can get text, Baruch Hashem.
You don't care anymore. You don't care about diamonds anymore, and you don't care. If the car is good, good, it doesn't have to be so fancy. As long as it drives good. Change, you change your mentality. You understand? So, Bilam wants to live like a Jew. Tamut nafshi. He wants to die like a Jew. Tamut nafshi mot yesharim. Yesharim mitzam Yisrael yeshurun. And my end v'tihi achariti, and my end should be kamo, like them. Meaning, from here you learn that the Jews and the non-Jews have a different end. But not physical different end. The end over here, it's the same. He dies from corona, he died from corona. The Jew and the goy. Or cancer. Or car accident. Or any other way. Or he got old and died. There's no difference whatsoever between the death of Jews and goyim anywhere in the world. Never in the history there was a difference. Never. You stab a Jew, you stab a goy, they're both going to die. If they both get corona, they can die. Accident, they can die. Every fool knows it. Needless to say, Bilam the prophet, Yodea Da'at Elyon, that he knows to aim to the second of Midat Adin of Hashem. Chazal said that Hashem gave him abilities like Moshe Rabbeinu, that the goyim will not say you deprive that. It's not fair. They had Moshe, we didn't have anyone. Hashem gave them Bilam. So Bilam, he says a prophecy. I want to die like a Jew, and I want to go where the Jews go. From here you see that the heaven of the Jews and the heaven of the Goyim is totally different level. I wish to many Jews to go to the heaven of the Goyim. It's not going to happen because there's heaven for Jews and heaven for Goyim. But believe me, many Jews will be very happy to go to the heaven of the Goyim because they are not going to any heaven, unfortunately, with the way they live. Someone has mechalel Shabbat, has no share to the world to come. The Torah says, I'm going to cut that soul out of my nation in the afterlife. And that soul will be cut. And there's a few other things. Eating chametz in Pesach, eating on Yom Kippur. There's a list of 36 sins in the Torah that the punishment for that is cut for the soul. Most Jews are ignorant. They never learned Torah. They never read the Torah. The fact that you don't know what the Torah says does not change reality and does not change your reality. If you drive in a specific area and there was a school there and you didn't know, you didn't see there is a sign school zone. So instead of 45, you have to drive 20 over there. You didn't see. A really innocent mistake. 45 is not so fast. But there was a sign, school zone or double fine. And a police pull you over, and you swear to him, connect me to a lie detector. I had no idea. I always obey the rules. I didn't know this is a school zone. What the police say? Tough luck. Not knowing the law does not dismiss the punishment. Everybody understand this rule, and that's the way it is. Why don't you know the rules? Because you don't come to learn. If you learn Torah, if you read the Torah, you would already know what should be done and what should not be done. Because you don't learn, you have all the time in the world to invest in other books. But when it comes to the main book in the history, the book of God, you don't even open it. You don't even read it. Then you come with, no, it's not fair. If I knew, I would keep Shabbat a long time ago. Why didn't you know? Because you never learned. But you saw thousands of Orthodox Jews keep Shabbat strictly. It did not raise attention by you. Maybe I live in a lie. Maybe the truth is by them. Maybe I'm half a goy. Maybe I'm not faithful to my creator. Maybe I'm a big criminal. Maybe I'm making horrible sins, not being aware of what I'm doing. Let me at least go and clarify it. Let me go check. But Rashi writes, Rashi writes, someone who knows there is a God. And he knows the Jews got the Torah from this God. The Jews and no other nation. And he knows about the existence of the Sabbath. He doesn't know details. He just knows that Shabbat exists. That's already make him not Tinok Shenishba. He cannot claim I'm a baby that was captured by the Goyim when I was a baby.
It's not fair. I didn't know all these things. Why should I be punished? No. Three things. You know there is a God? Yes, I do. You know there is a Torah? Yes, I do. You know there is such a day Shabbat? Yes, I do. That's it. You're guilty of all your sins. Okay, fine. I knew some of it and I kept some of it, but I didn't know all the rules. It's your fault. Why didn't you come to learn? When you buy something today in a supermarket, 10 minutes you check the ingredients. One guy is a vegetarian, the other one is for sugar, diabetic, the other one is allergic, right? Everyone who has a problem, how many times you check? Check again, come to the light, maybe I miss it, maybe it's too small. Why? God forbid, I once had an assistant that was allergic to eggs. Every time we went places, poor guy, 10 minutes he had to check, ask what's in it, there is eggs in it, no eggs. I asked him, what would happen if you eat eggs? So you don't want to know. He said, my head will blow up double size. Did you ever hear such thing? You have a head, imagine now the head became double on the side. And it can cause death. Allergic to eggs. That's all. One person is allergic to lima beans, the Kurdish. If they eat it, they can die on the spot. I once had a Kurdi guy in my table. He had it already in his spoon. And he said, what is this? He said, full. Full means these big lima beans. Oh my God, by the way, he dropped it. My sister ate it and died. We're all allergic for it. Meaning it would die on my Shabbat table. Another second. Just lima beans. That's it. They die. There's all kinds of things like this. So you check 10 times, 50 times. Make sure. Why when it comes to the book of God, you don't check 1,000 times? There's a lot of death penalties over there. You're not afraid? There are two options. Either you don't believe in God, or you're just a fool. One of the two. Because someone that is smart will never take the risk having a book of God on a shelf and not out of curiosity. Out of fear. What's going to be my end? Out of fear. How can I ignore it? How can I ignore it? If you would get a FedEx from President Trump, even if you are a liberal lefty trader, when you see a stamp of the White House, a personal letter from President Trump, and you hate him, you're a liberal, you're a lefty, you love Hamas, you love gay parades, you love Hezbollah, you love all kinds of other things that Hashem hates, but you don't love the president. Wouldn't you open right away out of curiosity? Let's see what he has to say. Imagine if you leave it on a shelf and never open it. People would say, this guy is not normal. You know a normal person will leave it sealed? So if a letter from a president, a normal person right away would run out of curiosity to see what he has to tell me, after all, he's the president of my country, let's not mess with him, no? The creator of universe gave you a letter and you failed to read it, You failed to understand what's in it? If that's not a crime, what's a crime? So let's go back to what I asked you. Why do we read Vashem Pakad et Sarah and the next day Vayachar Devarim Haele Akedah? Chazal explained, because when Sarah came to Avraham and she said, throw Ishmael out of the house, he was very upset. Very upset. You're telling me to throw my son from a different woman to the street? Where is he? He's going to go in the desert, he's going to die. Hashem needed to interfere, and he came to Avraham and said, Sarah, whatever she tells you, listens to her. Listen to her, because she's speaking to you in a prophecy. And what happened? It's real, it's a verse. Kol asher tomar lecha Sarah tishma bekola. Everything Sarah tells you, listen to her. What does it mean? Take your son and throw him out. And he gave them water and some bread, which was enough for one day barely. And they went in the middle of the desert. I don't have to tell you the heat in the desert in Israel. It's about 110 degrees, killing sun, and your water is finished. You have maybe 2-3 hours to survive. So she started to cry for him, and he cries for himself. And right after that, it's written, Vayishma Hashem et kol ha'na'ar. Hashem heard the voice of Ishmael crying for his life. I want to remind you, at that time, Ishmael is a murderer, is an idol worshiper, is Rove Kashat, is murdering all day for living, murdering, killing, is a dangerous person. No wonder Sarah said, get rid of him before he's going to turn Yitzchak to be like him. So he's a very despicable person, and he screamed to Hashem, and Hashem immediately makes them a miracle, and they find water. And his life is saved. Why do we read this in the first day? Chazal say, if Abraham will not throw Ishmael out of the house, Yitzchak will never become the holy person that he became. That's how Yitzchak became holy. When you got rid of the wicked neighbor. If you have bad friends, they are taking you to hell with them. Why? Because they give you very bad influence. They smoke grass and they give you other drugs and they suggest all kinds of bad movies to you. Let's hang out. Let's come over. And there's never going to be a good thing. Always bad things. Let's go to the club and let's buy more drugs and let's get drunk. And all kinds of other things, Rabotai, I don't have to tell you. I'm sure you know what I'm talking about. That's why the book of Tehillim, Psalms, King David, after the Torah, Tehillim comes in the next one. You can't live without it. You can't live without Tehillim. What's the first verse in Tehillim? David HaMelech makes an opening statement to his book. I don't have to tell you that the first line is the most important one to get the attention of the reader. What's the first line? Ashrei mi shelo yashav b'moshav letzim. How lucky is a soul that did not sit with the clowns, with jokers, with wicked people, with infidels, with heresy, with all kinds of people that all they care about is to joke around. That's how you become wicked. Tell me who your friends and I tell you who you are. I give you an example. If you come to someone's house and you walk in and you see 10 teenagers sitting over there, all with all kinds of weird haircuts and all kinds of earring and piercing and full of tattoos, and they all look stoned, and you ask the owner of the house, which one of them is your son? He said, no, my son is not here. He's going to be here any minute. Do you already know how the son looks, or you don't know? You already know not to expect as a nice Bachur Yeshiva to walk in, right? If the son will be Bachur Yeshiva, you get the shock of your life. You already know what's going to come in. Another zombie with ponytail and holes in his jeans and earrings all kinds of places and full of tattoos everywhere. How do you know? You a prophet? No. Tell me who your friends and I'll tell you who you are. A real serious learner, holy Bachur Yeshiva, is going to walk around with guys like this? He won't allow to be seen with them for 1 second a year. A second a year. Even if one of them was his brother, he will make sure nobody will see him standing next to him. Why? I don't want people to get the wrong impression about me and give me the wrong reputation. If a woman walks around with girls that modesty is not exactly what they are into, totally, totally provocative, that gives her a very bad reputation. Why? Tell me who your friends and I tell you who you are. One of the main rules in Torah is move to a kosher area. Don't live in a bad neighborhood. The Gemara say a rich man came to Rav Yossi Bar Kisma. He was a very big chacham. He told him, I would like you to move to our town We will pay you any amount of money you want. We'll give you an open check. You write the amount. Come and teach us Torah. Big mitzvah, no? To go to a town of people that don't know Torah and teach them Torah. And you're going to make a new community over there of Shomrei Shabbat and people that learn in yeshiva. Unbelievable. But there's one problem. You have children. What kind of examples your children are going to get in this town? They see all the spoiled, rotten, modern American kids that don't care about anything holy. No, not to pray. Not all they have in their mind is rak shtuyot and sport and movies and smartphones and sport cars. That's all they care about. They have no connection to Hashem, nothing. So what do you think is going to happen to your children after a year or two? They're all going to become like that. You came to save strangers, and all your children became half goyim. They don't want to daven. Leave me alone. You're too fanatic. What caused that? You show them the other kinds of people. They influence them. I never forget, I invited a group of Israeli guys once to my house 20-something years ago. One of them had tattoos in his arm. So, you know, he takes off his shirt. He sits in his room without a shirt. The kids, they play cards. All of a sudden, I see my two little boys. One took a marker, and he's drawing on my other son's shoulder. I said, well, what are you doing? On Shabbat. He said, he has it. I want to have the same thing. One picture. Well, he wants already to have a tattoo. What do you think would happen when he see that they smoke grass? When they go outside and smoke, or smoke on Shabbat? He will also want to try. That's the nature of people. They are influenced easily by society. For good or for bad. I can give you an example. There is a group of Bukharian people who moved from Queens to Muncie. Each one of them is top Bnei Torah. Serious Bnei Torah. If they stayed in Queens, they would not be half of what they are. Not that Queens is bad. Queens is a million times better than all other places. But compared to Muncie, is a much lower level, spiritually. The fact that they realized that when they had little kids, they got up, sold their homes and moved to Muncie, and all their children grew up in serious yeshivot and great atmosphere, not one car in a whole Shabbat. Everyone is religious, there's no goyim there, no secular Jews. All clean. All you see is people that are religious. And that's all you see. Every other building is mikveh, yeshiva, synagogue, mikveh, yeshiva, synagogue. That's all you see. You don't see cars driving, main street, people cursing, loud music. You don't have it. You have to see their children one by one. Each one is a potential rabbi already. What would come out of them here? The society, the environment, is the main thing in life. Rambam say, the nature of a person is to follow his friends and his environment. That's why you cannot control it. Once you're there, you're there. It also depends who you invite to your house on Rosh Hashanah. Make sure who you invite. If you invite people that talks about business and real estate and sport and jokes, your entire year would look lousy. Why? Instead of holiness and Torah and Tehillim, your Rosh Hashanah was a joke. It affects the entire year. Same thing, Leila Seder. Passover night, why we call it Leila Seder? Seder means order. It makes order in your entire year. From this Leila Seder until next year, everything in your life will be in the right order and the right timing, if you do it properly. If you joke around, you turn on television, I don't have to tell you how your year is going to look. One more thing we have to know. We read in Rosh Hashanah about barren women. Sarah, barren. In Haftarah of the first day, we're talking about Chana and her husband Elkanah. He has two wives, Chana and Pnina. Pnina has many kids. Chana cannot have kids. She's barren. She's begging Hashem, give me one child, I'll dedicate him for you. She comes to her husband Elkanah. Well, I don't have children. What does he say? Why do you need children? I'm better for you than 10 children. Typical Israeli answer. Why do you need kids? You have me. I'm better than 10 kids combined. That's what he tells her. Sarah comes to Abraham. I cannot have kids. Maybe you should go with this Arab, Hagar, the Egyptian. Maybe you should have kids with her. Instead of saying, God forbid, I'll never do such thing to you. We'll continue to pray to Hashem until we'll have a child with you. Right away, took Hagar. Then the second day, in the Haftarah, we speak about Rachel. Mini kolech mi bechi. Don't cry, there is a reward to your actions. Kol barama nishma, Rachel mevachar. It's heard everywhere. Rachel is crying for her children. Yaakov buried her on the way. Not in the Me'arat HaMachpelah in Hebron. Why? That when Jews pass by, they go in and they pray, and she is able to cancel all decrees from the Jewish nation. What's so special about her? She gave up her man, Yaakov Avinu. He was meant for her. Her crook father tricked Yaakov and switched her with Leah. And Yaakov already knew he's dealing with a crook, so he made a password with her. Because remember, in the old days there was no electric, no light. You come at night to the tent, you know there is a woman there, but you don't see anything. It's not like today, you have light, turn on the light, you see everything. Hey, shut the light, it's too much light. You're in a very, very strong darkness. So when he comes into the room, are you Rachel? Yes, I am. What's the password? She knows the password, Leah. Who gave her the password? Rachel, that she won't be embarrassed. She's willing to give up the love of her life, her future. And the biggest thing is, to save Leah, she was destined to go with Esav. Everybody knew one will go with Yaakov, one will go with Esav. It was known in the family. The one who will marry Yaakov, the other one will have to marry Esav. Meaning, Chas v'Shalom, she's going to end it up with the founder of the Nazis, and Amalek. Esav, Rachel, can you believe this? And she still cooperated, not to embarrass her sister. In the end, Hashem had mercy on her, and he made her also the wife of Yaakov. She did not fall in the hand of Esav. And Yosef came out of her. And the rest is history, but she died young. She gave birth to Binyamin, she was 36. She died young. Yaakov had a horrible life, if you think about it. First, his brother wants to kill him. His own brother wants to kill him. He has to run away from his family, never to see them now. Second, they took away his loved son, Yosef. 17 years, he's gone. He's sure they killed him, an animal ate him up. Imagine you have a son, you learn with him to ride every day, they come, animal, a bear ate him, a lion ate him. What a horrible tragedy. Then the guy raped his daughter Dina. I don't know which one is worse, to lose a child to an animal or that she fell in the hand of a different animal. So imagine already how much he has on his head. He lost his family, his brother is looking for him to kill him. He lost all his money. Eliphaz came, he wanted to kill him. He said, take everything I have. If a person becomes totally poor, it's count like he died. So like this, you fulfilled your father's mission. So he left with no money. He goes to Lavan, 20 years he takes advantage on him. Servant of a crook, 20 years. And push him after 7 years, a different girl. He wasn't interested in her. Now he has to work 7 more years for the one he wanted. So 7 years he worked for free for this crook. And then 6 more years to get some sheep, and that also with miracles. If it would be depend on Lavan, it would let him go empty-handed. So what a life he had. Horrible life. Then there was hunger. Then they come and say to him, Binyamin is also captured. What? Not only I lost Yosef, now I lost Binyamin. You have to come to Egypt. Finally, the last 17 years of his life was good. Until then, he had a horrible life. Many of the people like this, David HaMelech, Yosef, parts of his life was put in jail when he's innocent. Avraham Avinu, Yitzchak, Esav, the Plishtim fighting with him, closing his wells. So we see the fact that you're very righteous doesn't mean you're not going to have a tough life. Actually, Hashem already told Yaakov Avinu he wanted to rest in peace. I retired. Let me retire. Sit by the pool, read magazines, eat steaks, barbecue, and some good fish on the grill. Wake up at 11. Wow, great. I work hard all my life, no? Right away, Yosef. Right away, Dina. Right away, no problem. Hashem said, not only the tzaddikim have a world to come with great pleasure, they want to enjoy here also. Don't be too greedy. Have patience. A great thing is coming to you. Over here is a place of hard effort. You didn't come here for a picnic. This world is not a picnic like most Jews think. Cancun, Acapulco, cruise. Get it out of your nonsense. Get it out of your head. Over here, Adam la'amal yulad. A person was born for hard work. Hard work. Do not waste time. Every minute will never return. That's the whole goal here. So the question is, why do we read about three barren women? Sarah, Hannah, and Rachel. What's the connection to Rosh Hashanah? Besides the fact that they conceived on Rosh Hashanah, there is one very big secret. Very big secret here. The secret is, all three women had a righteous husband, the biggest. You can't find bigger than Avraham Avinu, right? Elkanah is a very big tzaddik. And Yaakov Avinu is Israel, Yaakov, Bechir Avot. With a husband like this, there is nobody else to turn to. Your husband is the chief of the world. He is the holiest person. He can do things by Hashem. So Sarah is hoping that Avraham will do something. Instead, he takes Hagar and have a child. Hannah is hoping Elkanah will do something. He tells her, I'm better than children for you. Don't make a big deal out of it. Rachel comes to Yaakov and she says, Hava li banim v'imayin meta anochi. Give me children and if not, I'm dead. And Yaakov answered to her, what do you want from me? I'm God? Go to God. I cannot help you. I have children with Leah. The problem is by you. Go to Hashem. When those three women realize my salvation will not come from my righteous husband, I better talk only to Hashem and not to middlemen. That's when the salvation came. That's a very big lesson to all the foolish Jews that worship the rabbis, whether they are alive, whether they already died. And they will search and go crazy just to go to their graves without realizing that slowly, slowly they're becoming idol worshippers. Respect your rabbi, yes. Admire his Torah and holiness, yes. Learn from his behaving, yes. No, who say no? And definitely, definitely never dare to disrespect any chacham, not only your rabbi. Needless to say, your own rabbi, that you owe him a lot. There's nobody asking, nobody questioning this. That's a solid rules in the Torah. Kvot chachamim, izayer begachaltam. If you don't respect a chacham, you're going to get burned just from his holiness in the world to come. Someone who disrespected a rabbi, which is a kosher one, there is no cure to his problems. It's crazy to take such a risk. However, you have to know where is the line. Once you turn him into a god, into your idol, and your success in the future, you making it depend on him, and you pray to him, he's going to save me, he's going to take me out of hell, he's going to do this for me, he's going to give me children, then you're nothing better than these foolish Christians who bow down to JCPenney. Nothing better. Actually, you're going to get a much bigger punishment than them. Why? Because you learn Torah. You learn Gemara. You learn the principle of Judaism. You learn Sifrei Musar. And you still did it. What did they learn, these Christians? Show me one real book that they learned in their life. Did they ever learn Gemara? Even the Torah they learned with nonsense commentary. They don't learn the real commentary on the Torah. What do they know, these Muslims, these Christians? Did they have a chance to get education like we get? They did not learn 1% of what we have. Everything by them is nonsense. So the idea is, what opportunity they have? Nonsense, nothing. We have it, we read it, and in the end you're going to go and worship the rabbi. So what do you want to say? That he's holy? Fine, we agree. That he was a righteous man? We agree. That he has great books? We agree. That Hashem loves him? We agree. What else do you want? But where does it say that you're allowed to worship him? Where does it say such thing? That's when it becomes very dangerous, to the point that some people already said, if my rabbi will tell me to eat pork, I eat. I don't ask questions. That means you have a different God. You're not a servant of Hashem. You're a servant of a man, of a human being. I saw somebody that told me that once. I don't ask questions. If he tell me to eat chazir, and yochel, I eat. That's when you already lose your mind. You already lost your mind. This is some of the secrets of Rosh Hashanah. We are now in Aseret Yemei Teshuva. As you know, the Gemara says in Masechet Rosh Hashanah, three kinds of books are opening. The living, the dead, and the mediocre. Tzadikim, righteous people, immediately signed for life. Wicked, immediately signed for death. And mediocres are pending. Pending. Not for life, not for death, yet. Meaning, the idea, that you have to think, the way you have to think is that your head is on the rope and the floor below you is about to open any minute between now and Yom Kippur. You know the feeling? How intense you are? Oh my gosh, every second is going to open. I don't know. Maybe I survive and it won't open until Yom Kippur and I get out of the hook. But maybe it will open the floor and maybe I will be hanged. That's the feeling that a person has to have between Rosh Hashanah and Kippur. Now let's not kid anyone. We already know that we're not in this level. The reason is because if we were in this level, we would not stop learning for 1 second between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur and we won't sleep one night. Just from the pressure, maybe we're not yet positive on a scale. We're mediocre, that means we are 50-50. That means we have to do the next mitzvah right now and turn everything to the positive. Or maybe the next one, or maybe the next one. So the question is, what does it mean righteous people immediately signed for life? What does it mean? Who knows? We see that righteous people sometimes die. Here, two righteous people died today in Monsi in a horrible accident. I don't know if you heard about it. Two Hasidim. Last night, 1:45 a.m., they came back probably from the Monroe exit 14B on Monsi. A huge semi-trailer truck smashed them and it went on fire. If you saw how the car looked, you would not stop crying. Thinking how two Jews died in such a car, it's got smashed like a pita bread. But the worst thing is not only it's stoning, it was stoning, burning, choking, everything in one transaction. Arba mitot bedin. Two young boys, I saw the picture. One of them I even recognize. I've seen him around in Monsi. That means that they were wicked, God forbid. Now I'm going to explain this Gemara. The Gemara, obviously the Chachamim, when they wrote it 2,000 years ago in the Gemara, they know that the Tzadikim, some of them died after Rosh Hashanah. Not everybody would live forever. And many wicked people continue to live. But they told you immediately the Tzadikim for life, the Reshaim for death. They're not talking about life in this world, obviously. Because right away everybody would come and say, excuse me, rabbis, what are you talking about? What kind of world are you talking about? In our world, 80% of the people here that are not righteous, they continue to live. Why they don't sign immediately in the book of death? Because the answer, we are not talking about this world. We are talking about life of eternity. When Rosh Hashanah comes, if you had a good year, you were very good, and you did a lot of mitzvot, and lots of charity, and lots of Torah, and you improve your bad traits. Immediately Hashem marks a V. Reuven, V. It was a positive year. This guy, negative. Death. Still alive. Another 20 years he would live. We're not talking about the Every year it's conclusion of the year. If you die today, will I send you to life of eternity or will I send you to death of eternity, God forbid? Which place I would send you? According to your record right now, if I take you from the world, you are signed to death, chas v'shalom. In Olam Haba, not here. Here you have the biggest tzaddikim. They have to die eventually. It's 93, 95, 98. Of course they're going to die after Rosh Hashanah. It's always going to be like that. That doesn't make them wicked. When you see righteous people die young, that's a sacrifice for all of us. You should know that. Those decrees of who's going to live and who's going to die, obviously, are made in Rosh Hashanah. These two poor Hasidim, one day earlier, Hashem signed them for death in this world also. Maybe now they're in heaven, but in this world, their life was short. I don't think they made it to 40. In their 20s? One is 30, one in his 30s, one in his 20s. So the idea, Rabotai, we always have every year, we have this kind of tragedies that people get burned in car. Did you realize this or no? Or in a house. The seven kids of Sassoon family, the family of eight in Israel that got burned in a car. Another incident of few children. Now another two young boys. This corona with so many big rabbis and chachamim passed, meaning there is a big midat adin in the world, big judgment on us in the world. Hashem is furious at the entire world and on us especially. I have to say the truth. Especially on us. We do not meet His requirement. Now I would like to read to you, what does it mean to do tshuva? We have 25 minutes left. We have 25 minutes left. And let's see a little bit, what does it mean tshuva? Let's give us some, I'm not going to have time to read everything. If you want to review the entire tshuva, I have it in CD number one. Laws of Repentance series. It's six lectures. Everybody must listen to it, especially now before Yom Kippur. This is just give you some tips, like a preview. All the mitzvot of the Torah, whether it's positive commandments or negative commandments, if a person violated one of them, whether he did it intentionally or not intentionally, when he repents and stops with the sin, he must confess. Confession. Shamnu, Bagadnu, all these confessions that we do when we pray. He must confess. Vidui, it's a positive commandment. One of the 613, to confess for your sin in front of Hashem. Ana Hashem, chatati, aviti, pashati lefanecha. I made intentional sins, not intentional sins. I actually made intentional sins on purpose to get you upset. All kinds of things like that, right? And I'm ashamed with my action, and I never ever go back to do it again. That's called repentance. Regret, shame and confess. The more you confess, the better it is. Don't be like these people in a shul. 15 seconds, they finished. Think. Stand in front of Hashem and you confess. You're standing in front of the judge of the universe. You don't want to show him that you're in a rush to go home. Do a confession in the right way. Ashamnu, bagadnu. However, when it comes to the sins of niafnu, meaning sex crimes, quickly. Skip it quickly. Just say it and go. Don't start thinking about your sins. Because sins about lack of modesty, the thought about it, it's already a sin. You see, when you think about that you broke Shabbat and you're upset about it, that's not a sin. Wow, I used to drive a car on Shabbat, shame on me. That's not a sin. That's a good confession. But when you had a non-Jewish girlfriend and now you're thinking about your sins and you begin to forget about the world, going back to the days you used to make sins, all kinds of bad thoughts coming to your mind, you now, in the middle of confession, adding more sins to your fight. That's why you have to go quickly on this one only. The rest you can do. Ashamnu, bagadnu, gazalnu. When it comes to this, pagamnu bod brit kodesh, quickly. Don't stop here and become the Baba Sali. Oh, thinking about every woman he ever been with now. Not good. That's the advice of the Satan. Also, I made on Thursday a lecture about Tikkun HaBrit. If you realize, it's been many years until I gave this lecture. I used to give a lot of these lectures in the past, but then for many years I didn't give. I saw other speakers give, I said it's good enough. Why is it? It's not good to talk about this topic. It brings you back to your own sins of the past. Not only that, Rav Hoffman, in the psychology of the mind, is the world expert in the mind and the subconscious. He said that the more you talk to people about this sin, the more desire later on they will have to do it. Right now it's effective. You get them scared. But a week later, it's already planted in the back of their mind to constantly come back to them to do it again. So what do you have to do? You don't have to go to focus too much. You just have to say it's a very big sin and go and move on. Not too much to talk about it. Why? The more you talk about it, the worse it gets. This is something that you need to get gray hair to understand. You don't understand it when you have black hair. It may take you 20 years to understand how the mind works. But the mind of a person works, the more you tell a person something, the more he's after it. Even if you warn him. Sometimes you come to your child, be careful, don't touch drugs, don't touch, be careful, look, heroin is going to kill you. What does he do a month later? You find him with heroin. What caused that? All this conversation. It's a no-win situation. You want to do the right thing and warn him not to do it. On the other hand, you're planting things in the back of his mind and he gets very curious. Why my father warned me so many times from it? Why? Why it's so bad? I have to see why. The mind of a person works in a mysterious way. If you don't know, you may pay later on a very serious price. So what's the idea? Not to make a big deal out of these things with your teenager children. You talk about it in a lecture here and there, they get the point and that's it. Too much talking about it makes more damage. And the Rambam over here is speaking about confession. And he said, the more you confess, the better it is. In the time of Beit HaMikdash, they used to bring sacrifices for those sins. Today we don't have sacrifices, so what we have left? Praying. Confession with words. And praying. If you owe money to people, obviously you have to pay. If you made a financial damage to someone, you broke something, you hit someone's car, and you did not pay, you have to go and pay. there is no way to repent between you and other people before you pay them back the money you owe them, or that you actually make them forgive you. If they say, I forgive you, you don't have to give me the money. You don't have to pay for the damage. It's okay. I will keep the car like this. It's no big deal. I won't fix it. I don't want money. That's when you are dismissed. But as long as you didn't pay, you have a problem. Also, when even though repentance, when you do tshuva, it's repenting, and the Yom HaKippurim comes and like wipe it out from your file, there are some sins that is erased immediately, and some sins after a while. For instance, if you violated a positive commandment without that doesn't have karet, there's no cut for the soul, and you did tshuva, it's forgiven immediately. You're embarrassed, you're ashamed, you accept on yourself not to repeat that mistake, you make a confession that day, boom, it's over. Why? Shenemar shuvu banim shovavim erpa meshuvotchem. As you will return, immediately I will send you remedy. If you violate restrictions of the Torah, meaning you should not do, that's more serious. If it's a restriction that does not have karet, that the Torah did not say on that specific restriction that is a cut for the soul, and there is no death penalty in Sanhedrin, and a person did tshuva, the tshuva helps, but is pending until Yom Kippur. When Yom Kippur will come, you will have a forgiveness. It may take 7, 8, 9 months, depending on what time of the year you did tshuva, yeah? Where does it say it? Ki bayom hazeh yechaper alechem, because of that day I will repent for you. Right? Lifnei Hashem titaru, you will be purified in front of Hashem. If he made a sin that has a cut for the soul, karet, like breaking Shabbat, idol worshipping, eating on Yom Kippur, eating chametz and Pesach, some of the sex crimes, homosexuality, those sins that have a cut for the soul in the Torah, once he repent and regret and ashamed and confessed and Yom Kippur pass, is still pending. He needs to get suffering. Without suffering, it will never be erased. Sheneemar, ופקדתי בשבט פשעם ובנגעים אבונם. I will send them all kinds of suffering and sicknesses. Anxiety attack, panic attack, cannot sleep at night, heart attack, cancer, radiation, chemo, bankruptcies, all kinds of other mental issues. And half of the world, or maybe 80% of the world, has at least one sickness, physical or mental. Almost every person in the world, you ask him, are you completely cured? Most of them are not. One has sugar, one has cancer, one has corona, one has lung issues, one has heart condition, one has mental condition, one has bipolar, one has schizophrenia, one has depression, chronic depression, almost every person has at least one thing. If you don't have anything, it's already you're very lucky. You know, that you function normally and you're healthy and you don't have all kinds of pain, back pain, knees, replacement, all these things, stomach, ulcer, Crohn disease, all kinds of sex diseases, hundreds of different diseases just when it comes to this. All right, fatigue, migraines, who knows what, weaknesses, all kinds of problems. This is all a part of the sins, right? What are we talking about? All the restrictions that have karet, but not chilul Hashem. Disgracing the name of Hashem, meaning people know you're a Jew and you're making sins in public, that's already called chilul Hashem. The way you behave in public and you make people upset and angry and they begin to think this is the face of religion, that's how religious people behave, that's called chilul Hashem. So even if you regret and you ashamed and you confess and Yom Kippur pass
and you got a lot of suffering, it cannot be erased until the day of death, which is written, שנאמר, ונגלה באוזני השם צבאות, אם יחופר האבון הזה לכם, אתם מותון. I'm informing you today that this sin will never be erased to you until the day of your death. And which sin we are talking about here? As an example of Chilul Hashem in the Torah. The Torah gave us an example that these sins cannot be erased. What is a complete tshuva? What's considered a complete tshuva? When a person has a sin that he was used to do every day, and now he has an opportunity to do it, and he did not do it because he repent. Not because he became old, or sick, or poor, that he cannot fulfill this sin. No. He still can do it, with no limitation. But, he chose not to. And the Rambam gives an example. By the Rambam, nothing is coincidence. If he gives this example, that's because it's the hardest thing. Meaning, if you are able to do this, everything else should be easy compared to this. And the Rambam gives an example. What's the example? Ketzad. Hare sheba alisha be'avera. He had a girlfriend. He lives with her like a husband and wife. No shame. And then he became religious, and they broke up. He broke up with her. And now they were together in a place that they could make a sin again. No one was there, no one stopped them. It was just if he would choose to do it or not. She's already begging him, and he's thinking, should I do or should I not? Ve'piresh ve'lo avar, and he ran away and did not break that violation. Hare ze ba'al tshuva gamur. Baal Tshuva Gemura. Someone like this is an example of someone that is a serious, complete Baal Tshuva, that he was willing to give physical pleasure and addiction that he likes for the sake of heaven. Then you know everything else he can do with food, with money, with everything else. He did not make the sin because he's very old now. In his late 70s, he cannot perform anymore, he cannot function. Is this considered a tshuva or no? If it was up to him, he would make the sin, but he can't. Af al pi she'ena tshuva meula, even though it's not a superb tshuva, it's not a perfect repentance, it's still considered repentance. Not perfect! Not perfect, but better than nothing. At least he stopped his sin. Remember, in his mind he regrets and he's ashamed and he confessed and Yom Kippur passed and another Yom Kippur. But if he would be put in that test, if he could have done the sin, he would do it. But now he can't. So because of that, he gets saved. So it's better this than nothing. When a person did tshuva before he died, even though most of his life he made sin, and when he was already old, he made repentance, all his sins will be forgiven, nimchalim. If he did a real good tshuva for every one of his sins. The problem with us today is that we all make partial tshuva. Partial, meaning, one person used to be a thief, he realized it's not the way, and he stopped to steal. But he's still doing other sins, like Lashon Hara, girls, stealing, no more. He's very good now with stealing, he stopped. One was Mechalel Shabbat, no more Mechalel Shabbat. He keeps Shabbat and holidays, but she's not modest. She's Shomeret Shabbat, but she dressed Hashem Yerachem. I don't want to tell you like how. You ask her, you're a religious woman, you keep Shabbat, look how you dress, what is this? No, it's hard for me. For Shabbat, she made tshuva. For modesty, absolutely not. Modesty have the worst punishments because it's not only a sinner, it's making other people commit sins by looking at her. It could be millions of sins in a week.
Everyone who looks at her on the street goes to her file. That's called משלם לאדם לפי מעלליו, לפי פרי מעלליו. I pay the person according to the fruits of his actions. Not according to his actions, according to the fruits of his action. What comes later on out of his sins? You drove a person crazy tonight in a club or in a bar. How are you? Dance with him, drive him crazy. Later on, he went and make a scene somewhere. You're still guilty for that scene, even though it took 2 hours later when you were not around. Because the person is guilty for what came because of his actions to the world. Even a year later, even 20 years later. 20 years later. If you build a club now in Manhattan, it may take you 5 years to build it. 5 years. And from the minute the club started to work, people come and make scenes over there, you could already be dead. You already went to a different world. You're still responsible for all the people that come to that club and make scenes. Once your son took over. Why? Because you're the founder. You're the one who opened that salon in Gomorrah place. Boys and guys coming. If he sells that, he's still responsible for all the sins that happens over there, and the new owner is also responsible because he has an obligation to close it, not to continue make people make sins. But the one who started it will always pay for all the sins that will be done in that place. But not only the sins that are done there, the sins that will be done later. I give you an example. A guy went to that club and he met a girl, and the girl was not Jewish. And he made her pregnant, and now he forced her to do an abortion. So how many sins this Jew made? First, he was with her, which is a sin. Going to the club is a sin. Dancing, it's chilul Hashem. Smoking with her some drugs and alcohol, yayin nesech, another few sins. Then went and made another sin with her, made her pregnant, and forced her to murder, and pay for the murder. So she gets a murder, the goya. She murdered a baby, and he is participant in the murder because he paid and sponsored and forced her to do it. So who's paying for that murder? The owner of the club. The owner of the club has a lot of murders in his file, and a lot of drug addicts, and a lot of forbidden relationship, and bad music, and drug distribution, and all kinds of prostitution. Everything goes to his club. If you open a yeshiva, what a lucky guy you are. All day mitzvot, Torah, 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 Torah. Hashem loves Torah, limud Torah keneged kulam. Hashem loves Torah. When the angel came to Joshua, Yeshua ben Nun, in a war, it was night. In the night you cannot fight. It's dark. You don't have light in the old days. It's 3,000 years ago. He came to Yeshua. And he said to him, Hashem send me. He's very upset at you people. Why did Hashem send you? Two sins you made. Today you did not sacrifice Korban HaTamid. You had enough time to sacrifice the sacrifice of the evening. The war stopped. You could quickly do it. But you didn't. That's negligence. And you don't learn Torah. Right now you're fighting? No. So why you don't learn Torah? You should learn Torah. Candles and learn Torah. Soldiers in the middle of a battle, in a field, in the mountains over there in Israel. So he asked him, which one of the two Hashem is more angry at? That we did not sacrifice the daily sacrifice? Or that we don't learn Torah? He said, for the learning Torah. For the learning Torah in the middle of a combat. What are we going to say? We're not in the middle of a war. Any second someone can shoot and burn an arrow into your head. Scary. You're going to turn the candle on. You're going to learn. The enemy will see a lot of candles. Somebody will come, the ambush. They're going to shoot you. No, it's scary. You don't learn Torah. It's a big crime. Limud Torah keneged kulam, bitul Torah keneged kulam. We have 5 minutes left. Let me just read one or two more halachot here. Even though... Tshuva and screaming is good for the person and for the world. In the 10 days between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, it's much better and much more accepted, easier. These 10 miracle days that we have, that Hashem gave us. This is what's written, Dirshu Hashem b'imatz'o. Search for Hashem when He's around, when He's close to you. When is He close to you? Rosh Hashanah to Yom Kippur. This Aseret Yemei Teshuva. Right? So a person should remember on Yom HaKippurim, we have 5 prayers. We have Arvit, and after that, Slichot. Shachrit, Slichot. Musaf, Slichot. Mincha, Slichot. Neila, Slichot. 5 prayers, 5 sets of Slichot. In the Slichot, all together, in each set, we say few times, Hashem, Hashem, El Rachum V'Chanun, Erech Apayim, right? How many times all together in Yom Kippur? 26 times. Numeric value of the name of God. Yud, it's 10. A, it's 5. Vav, it's 6. A, it's 5. Together, 26. 26 times, the Yud, Gimel, Midot, Arachamim of Hashem and Yom Kippur, all together. The Arabs, they try to imitate us in everything. Modesty of the women, they don't eat chazir, they call it chanzir. They don't eat chazir, they don't charge interest. A lot of the things that they do, it's come from our Torah. One of the things they do, they pray every day 5 times. Why? They saw that the Jews pray 5 times in the holiest day of the year, Yom Kippur. They say, we're going to be like this every day. We'll be better than you. Your women cover all their body, but not their face. We will cover the face also. Whatever we do, they try to prove that they are do better. No. So, Yom Kippur, the entire day is confessions. Confessions, confession. Ashamnu, bagadnu. This is all the slichot. What happened if you committed a sin to a friend, to someone, and he died? And you did not have a chance to ask for forgiveness. If you owe him money, you have to give it to the one that inherited him. Son or few sons, you give it to them. If it wasn't about money, you insulted him, you caused him depression, aggravation, pain, all kinds of things like this. You have to take 10 people to his grave and confess in front of them to him and ask him for forgiveness. This is the way to ask forgiveness to someone that died. Chatati le'Hashem and to this person that is buried here. This is what I did to him. And one more thing. Every person has good deeds and bad deeds. Someone that have more good deeds than bad deeds is on the positive side. This is what we call tzaddikim. Someone that has more negative than positive, that's what we call reshaim. Someone that is 50-50, that's what we call benoniim, mediocre. Same thing by the countries. Same thing by the cities. Some cities are holier than others. If you go to Lakewood, Monsey, Williamsburg, Borough Park, so many mitzvot, so much Torah, there's a lot more mitzvot, so there is a chance that those cities are in the positive sides of the scale. I don't know if that's the case, but at least there is a chance. But if you go to San Francisco, or you go to Tel Aviv, or you go to Manhattan, or you go to South Carolina, or you go to Venice Beach, places like this, you have, for every mitzvah you have a billion sins. So I don't have to tell you the situation of the scale over there. It broke a long time ago already, from the weight of the sins. So cities like this, when destructions come to the world, they are the first one to get it. The first one. That's why if you're smart, you don't live there. A lot of Jews move out of Manhattan now.
and out of California. They don't want to be in a liberal, democratic, lefty trader place. They're tired of it. Look what's going on here. The police is eliminated. The mayor is an idiot. Everybody here is an enemy of God. What am I doing here? Let me move to a different place. Besides that, it does not justify the rent anymore. That's it. Manhattan is finished. Courtesy of the mayor of New York and Corona. Nobody, no company wants to go back and rent rooms and offices over there. So therefore, all the value of the real estate in Manhattan went down already 50%. And will continue to go down. We are going back to days that you can rent a two-bedroom apartment for $1,200 like I used to do in 1991. It will happen. Believe it or not, apartments that now are $6,000-$7,000 will go down to $1,500. But who wants to go there even for free? Why would you want to live in a place that you see the anger of Hashem is on that place? Don't you see what Hashem did to those places? Don't you see the riots over there? Don't you see the anger? Don't you read Torah? Don't you see that every once in a while Hashem brings a tragedy to a place? Why would you want to go there? You have to run to a place when you know that people are righteous. They learn Torah. They do good deeds. People help each other. Synagogue, prayers, modesty of the women. Children are in Talmudei Torah. Nobody walks full of tattoos. Everyone has kippah, tzitzit. Women cover their hair. There's respect for the elders. That's where you want to live. Of course, nobody is perfect. Every city has their own problems. In this generation, there's a lot of hypocrisy, there's a lot of hidden crimes, there's a lot of things. Don't expect the religious world to be perfect. If you expect it, you're very naive. But after all, there's nothing to compare. With all the problems in the religious world, there's still nothing to compare. You have to think a million times where you want to raise your children. Would you rather raise them in a nice, good religious neighborhood, in a good school, with respect? No kids is a drug addict there. Everybody comes with dignity. People, the kids blessed for the food. You should see how they learn Torah. Holy, pure. This is all kids who are born with Taharat Mishpacha, where the women went to mikveh. Their souls are pure, good souls. That's where you want your children to grow, or you want them to grow in San Francisco, that by age 11 already is going to tell you, soon I'm going to marry my boyfriend. If that's the kind of kids you want, who am I to stop you? Go and get what you deserve. But if you're normal, if you still have a brain and conscience, you run out of the wicked places. Don't stay there, because the Gemara say, when the Satan comes to destroy those places, the angel of death, he does not distinguish between wicked and righteous anymore. Once there is a death sentence to a town, that's it. Everybody suffers. Nobody will save you in a place where the atomic bomb will fall. If Hashem decides to wipe out Tel Aviv with all the gays over there, you want to live there, but you're religious. But what are you doing there? Why are you living in a place when there's gay parade every 2-3 weeks over there, when people walk naked in the street? Why you want your children to see these filthy people? Why? The answer is because you don't have enough fear from God. If you had fear from God, you would think a million times where your children's going to be and what kind of people they will see. Because remember, whatever the children see, that's what they become. Why everyone in America walks naked all the way down? Because they saw all these rap singers, these animals that have no dignity, no culture, no education, no nothing, walk with the pants all the way down, and every other world is a curse, and all drug addicts and criminals, and walk with guns, and they became the heroes of the American kids. In China, you don't find kids like that. Chinese, they're all idol worshippers or atheists. They're not religious. But one thing the Chinese people know, our children will not see the American field. So in China, you cannot see that. There's no YouTube, no access to Facebook, to places that destroy the souls of the kids. So these Chinese communists are much smarter than us. They already make sure that their children will not be exposed. In Saudi Arabia, the same thing. They're not going to let their children watch this field. They're not going to let them have access to dirty movies. They won't let. Why?
They are closer to the Torah than these liberal Jews that live here in New York. All they want is to corrupt the world with their rotten ideology and lack of modesty. The more educated they are, the more wicked they are. That's a rule. What can you do? The more educated they are, the more wicked they are. I also realize that the more educated you are, the more you count on nature and not on Hashem. You count on the army, you count on the doctors, you count on science. The more university education you have, the more Hashem is not playing a key role in your life when it comes to your emunah, confidence. If I'm not going to get a degree, who is going to feed me? How am I going to support my family? All these kinds of heresy is usually for people that have high education. People that only have Torah education don't speak heresy like this at all. They know it's all from Hashem. They're not worried. They focus on their mission in life. You see it everywhere you go. Very obvious. Last thing for today. We know that on the first day of Rosh Hashanah, we don't blow the shofar because it was on Shabbat. Whenever Rosh Hashanah falls one of the 2 days on Shabbat, we don't blow the shofar. It's interesting because shofar is the main mitzvah of Rosh Hashanah. Tiku b'chode shofar b'kesel yom chagenu ki chok l'Yisrael hu mishpat le'eloi Yaakov. It's a clear verse. You blow the shofar when is the judgment to the God of Israel. He's judging the whole world. Ayom arat olam. Ayom, today, it's the birthday of the world, meaning Adam. It's Adam's birthday, Rosh Hashanah. That's why every year is a cycle of a judgment to all mankind, the children of Adam. So, shofar brings the judgment to mercy. Eliminate the Satan, confuse him, and he cannot present his cases against people. It's very interesting, Satan, numeric value, 364. Why? Because one day here, he does not have the power to speak against us. It's on Yom Kippur. All year round, he speaks non-stop against us, like a prosecutor. On Yom Kippur, he has no permission to speak. Especially in the last hour of Yom Kippur, which is Tfilat Ne'ilah, the most important hour of the year. In this week, next week, it will be Monday between 6 and 7. That will be the most critical hour of the year. That hour, you must cry and spill your heart out to Hashem. It's only you and Hashem. No more angels in a bed din, in a court. Hashem sent all the bed din out, the court of heaven. And now it's a father that judges you. Imagine your father is a judge of the Supreme Court. He has other judges. He can't really do whatever he wants. Now he said to everyone, excuse us, I want to stay with my son. You have this opportunity. That's when you have to accept on yourself to stop with this and to stop with that. Everything you know you do wrong. And cry to Hashem and ask for forgiveness for all your sins. Tfilat Ne'ilah can do miracles. An hour later, you miss the train. The Ari HaKadosh says, if a person doesn't cry on Yom Kippur, naturally, when you read the words of the Tfilot, you can also add to it Rosh Hashanah, because it's similar words. That means his soul is very impure. I don't understand how it's possible not to cry. The words are breaking the heart. Well, maybe Americans, they don't understand the words. Okay, possible. But for Israeli that understand most of the words, it's terrible. It cannot leave your eyes dry when you read about the words. It's mamash unbelievable. One of the things, for instance, you have the Vidui HaGadol. Vidui HaGadol de Rabbeinu Nisim. He finished the Vidui by saying, if I will come to reveal my sins, this is a person that lived 1,000 years ago almost, and I promise you did not stop to learn Torah a minute a day. That's all he was doing. Learning, 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 in holiness, full time, all his life. Nothing to walk on the street to see problems with modesty or chas v'shalom to eat something not kosher or one day to miss tzitzit. It wasn't even a test for them. All they did is Torah and prayers. Their connection, their soul was attached to Hashem like better than magnet. And he writes, if I will come to reveal my sins, the time on this world will end and my list will still go on. That's his words. That's how much I have to confess about. So what are we going to say? We don't reach 1% or 1% or 1% of his level. What are we going to say? We have to wake up. At least let's try. If we succeed or not, I don't know. That's why I always tell people, give a lot of charity. And some people, Baruch Hashem, listened to my advice. They did it. This year, for the first time. I think maybe people realize after the so with the corona, what happened, they realize today you have your money, tomorrow you will have nothing. At least let me give... At least let me give tzedakah now when I have it. Maybe next year I won't have it. Then I will eat my heart forever. When I had it, if I would give charity, I would lose it. Because I take the charity with me to the next eternal world. Now I don't have it. It's now everybody say, I wish I had the money, at least I would give it to tzedakah. Such a shame I lost it in the stock market. That's the whole point. You lost it in the stock market because for 20 years Hashem waited for you to give tzedakah. And when he saw you don't care about anyone, you're selfish. Nobody besides your stomach is your interest. Hashem decided to teach you a lesson and he took half of what you have. So now when you're broken and depressed, for years of your life went down the drain, he's expecting you to wake up and give more tzedakah. So what does the person say? Now when I lost so much, you want me to give? If before, I would give. But before, you didn't give. But now I lost. Why you want me to give more? Oh, that's a sign that you trust Hashem. When you lost, now I give more tzedakah. To show you I'm not afraid. I know I'm in your hand. In 1 minute you took it. In 1 minute you can give it back. Bezrat Hashem, tomorrow I'm going to speak in Brooklyn as usual, my weekly shiur. I'll speak a little bit more about Parashat Ha'azinu and also some of the tshuva. Wednesday I speak in 5 towns here, in Peninsula Boulevard. It will be, I think, an outdoor event. And Thursday I speak in a Kafkazi shul in Brooklyn. And that's it. That's it. Then Yom Kippur and Sunday night. Sunday during the day, please don't forget this mitzvah from the Torah to eat a lot. Even if you're in a diet. You eat a lot. Try to make at least 5 meals in a day. Start the day with a good bagel, an hour later something else. You can eat some mezonot also, but make sure you eat all day, also women. Why? Because it will count like you fasted 2 days. If you eat a lot on the 9th of Tishrei, 1 day before Yom Kippur. Don't forget we pray Mincha early. Don't wait for Mincha a minute before sunset, like every day. The Mincha in all the shuls will be around 1, 1:30, 2, maximum 3. There's a long confession in the end of Mincha. It's not a regular Mincha. Right? And don't forget also, the prayer of Sunday night is with the Talit. We make a bracha before sunset, the men. Put talit on and stay with the talit the entire night. When we say Shema Yisrael, usually we say Baruch Shem Kvod Malchuto with a whisper. This time we scream loud. There are some changes. Follow the rabbi of the place or the gabbai, whoever gives instruction, pay attention because there's some differences on the prayers. Very recommended to pray in sunrise. Sunrise is 6:43, will be 6:44. Meaning we start about an hour before at least. So it will be like 5:40, probably in most shuls they will start, 5:30, 5:40. It's very good. Those who will join me in Englewood, they will feel very spiritual. Every year, people that comes there, they say, well, it's the best Yom Kippur I had. There's no waste of time. we focus, we daven nets, we give shiur, I give shiur. After, then we have time to rest. Rabotai, this rest is critical. Why? Because usually if you pray, you start at 8 in the morning, you pray straight to 8 at night, it's very difficult. You stand, you sit, you stand, you scream. By the time you get to the Neila, you finished. And if you have 2 hours rest because you started to pray at 5:40 instead of 8, so now you have 2.5 hours to sleep, you get a new power and you come to Mincha like the Yom Kippur just started. It's a big difference, very big difference. And this is after learning at least an hour and a half. Also learning, like Musar and encouragements. Be'ezrat Hashem, Hashem helps when we give good lectures over there that opens the hearts of the people to do tshuva. בעזרת השם. ברוך אדוני לעולם, אמן ואמן. רבי חנניה בן הקשיא אומר הצעה, קדוש ברוך הוא.